there is something special about the city of Jerusalem. Jerusalem is referred to in the scriptures by many titles, not the least of which is the city of God's name. In Zechariah, it is known as the city of truth. The prophet Isaiah uses several euphemisms for Jerusalem. The faithful city, found in 1:25, the joyful city in 22:2, and the lion of God in 29:1, among many others. Now, it doesn't take much reading of the Bible to realize that Jerusalem is central throughout history and is ground zero for the events of the Bible. Israel had made a covenant with God at Mount Sinai. Look at Exodus 24:3-7. So Moses came and told the people all the words of the Lord and all the judgments. And all the people answered with one voice and said, "All the words which the Lord has said we will do." And Moses wrote all the words of the Lord. And he rose early in the morning and built an altar at the foot of the mountains and 12 pillars according to the 12 tribes of Israel. Then he sent young men of the children of Israel who offered burnt offerings and sacrificed peace offerings of oxen to the Lord. And Moses took half the blood and put it in the basins, and half the blood he sprinkled on the altar. Then he took the book of the covenant and read in the hearing of the people. And they said, "All that the Lord has said we will do and be obedient." This covenant was between God and the entirety of the people as a nation. In our Haftarah this week, Ezekiel lays out a series of condemnations against the people, phrased in terms as if the city of Jerusalem is the one who sinned. Now, why is it that the city of Jerusalem is referred to as a person? What does the city represent? And why is it that the city faces judgment? I'm Dan Cathcart, and this is Ancient Perspectives. Just as the people of Israel are set apart for service to God with the sons of Aaron, the Levitical priesthood, and the common people, so too is the land of Israel with the Temple Mount, the city of Jerusalem, and the entirety of the land of Israel. These form three divisions of sanctity, just like the temple itself, with the Holy of Holies, the holy place, and the outer courts. The city of Jerusalem is considered to be a holy place and is identified as such as the holy city in Revelation 21:2. Then I, John, saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. Now, holy simply means to be set apart. Jerusalem was set apart within Israel to be the place where God dwells among his people. With their pledge at Mount Sinai, the people had committed themselves to follow God's commandments and had accepted his invitation to be his chosen people. Yet time and again, the people sinned. Moses warned the people of the consequences of breaking the covenant that they had entered into. Let's go over to Leviticus 18:26-28. "You shall therefore keep my statutes and my judgments, and shall not commit any of these abominations, either any of your own nation or any stranger who dwells among you. For all these abominations the men of the land have done who were before you, and thus the land is defiled, lest the land vomit you out also when you defile it, as it vomited out the nations that were before you." Ezekiel was a Levite and a priest, which uniquely qualifies him to comment on the topic of holiness and sanctification. His writings are at the time of the beginning of the Babylonian exile, and he himself was included among the first to be deported to Babylon in 597 BCE. Ezekiel opens this section of prophecy with a denouncement of Jerusalem. No longer is it a holy, set-apart city, but Ezekiel now calls it the bloody city. Go to Ezekiel 22:1-3. Moreover, the word of the Lord came to me, saying, Now, son of man, will you judge? Will you judge the bloody city? Yes, show her all her abominations. Then say, Thus says the Lord God, The city sheds blood in her own midst, that her time may come. And she makes idols within herself to defile herself. The Hebrew phrasing of verse 2 indicates that much blood was shed in the city. Now this marks a sharp contrast to the purpose God intended for Jerusalem. God does not mince words here. Bloodshed was rampant. There was an enormous difference between this bloodshed and that which provides redemption. The corruption among the leaders of Judah was beyond intolerable. King Jehoiakim of Judah had led the people into deep idolatry. Jerusalem was to be a city of holiness, but it was now a city of shedding innocent blood. Through Ezekiel, God lays out their sins for all to see. The city had indeed backslidden. The shedding of blood was the main crime, but only one of many. Ezekiel enumerates no less than 20 specific sins in this short passage that were part of the city's daily lives of its inhabitants. So we will look at just a few of them here. Ezekiel 22:4. You have become guilty by the blood which you have shed, and have defiled yourself with the idols which you have made. You have caused your days to draw near, and have come to the end of your years. Therefore, I have made you a reproach to the nations, and a mockery to all countries. Idolatry was one of the first sins to be listed in the Torah. The people of God were to set no other god before him. Look at Exodus 20, 4-6. You shall not make for yourselves a carved image or any likeness of anything that is in the heaven above or in the earth beneath or in the water under the earth. You shall not bow down to them nor serve them, for I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, visiting the iniquity of the fathers on the children to the third and fourth generation of those who hate me, but showing mercy to thousands to those who love me and keep my commandments. Because of their backslidden status, they lost the respect of the rest of the world around them. How could they be held in high esteem if they forsook the God of their fathers? Ezekiel 22:5-8. Those near and those far from you will mock you as infamous and full of tumult. Look, the princes of Israel, each one has used his power to shed blood in you. In you they have made light of father and mother. In your midst they have oppressed the stranger. In you they have mistreated the fatherless and the widow. You have despised my holy things and profaned my Sabbath. Now verses 7 and 8 are particularly to the point. The Israelites were to honor their mothers and fathers and to keep the Sabbaths as clearly stated in the Ten Commandments or the Ten Words. Go to Exodus 20:8-9. Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work. Then skipping down to verse 12, it says, Honor your father and your mother, that your days may be long upon the land which the Lord your God is giving you. The inhabitants of Jerusalem were engaged in lewd sexual sins against their own family members and their neighbors, as we see in Ezekiel 22:9-11. In you are men who slander to cause bloodshed. In you are those who eat on the mountains. In your midst they commit lewdness. In you men uncover their father's nakedness. In you they violate women who are set apart during their impurity. One commits abominations with his neighbor's wife, another lewdly defiles his daughter-in-law, and another, in you, violates his sister, his father's daughter. Now Ezekiel's warning in these verses again points directly to the Ten Commandments, with further details found in Leviticus chapter 18. Exodus 20:13-17. You shall not murder, you shall not commit adultery, you shall not steal, you shall not bear false witness against your neighbor. You shall not covet your neighbor's house. You shall not covet your neighbor's wife, nor his male servant, nor his female servant, nor his ox, nor his donkey, nor anything that is your neighbor's." Now these are not petty crimes. They were clear violations of the covenant made with God at Mount Sinai. It is important to reiterate that this covenant was a national covenant, and this is reflected in the manner in which Ezekiel phrases this warning from God. Ezekiel addresses these violations by always referring to the city rather than to the people committing the actual crimes. Now, verse 6 clearly states that it was the leaders engaged in these acts and not the lower members of society. The leadership of Ezekiel's day was not leading the people to holiness and righteousness, but into sin. The Hebrew word for princes used in Ezekiel verse 6 is nasi, number 5387 in the Strong's lexicon, meaning king, prince, or ruler. These kings and rulers were themselves the murderers and the violators causing the shedding of innocent blood. Rabbi C.F. Keel, in his commentary on Ezekiel, comments, "By princes of Israel, we are to understand primarily the profligate kings who caused innocent persons to be put to death, such, for example, as Jehoiakim, found in 2 Kings 24, 4-6, and Manasseh, 2 Kings 21, 16, and others. Jerusalem was to be a holy city, the place where God dwells with his people. Jehoiakim was the father of King Jehoiakim, the king at the time of Ezekiel. Jehoiakim began the evil practices carried on by his son. Now Manasseh was the king who set up the abomination of desolation in the holy places, analogous to the city of Jerusalem. These unholy leaders of Ezekiel's day had sinned before the face of God in his dwelling place. It's as if they were performing their profanities and their abominations in the temple itself. They were the ones entrusted with and were responsible for maintaining the sanctity of the city. They had severely backslidden and corrupted the entire city. So Ezekiel addresses his warning to the city. Jerusalem was broken and beaten. They had a fair warning from the Torah of what was about to happen if they consistently and committed these sins without repentance. Now remember, in our last few teachings where we discussed King David, we found many of these same kinds of sins committed by him. But the difference was that David was convicted of his sins, repented from them, and returned to God. But these leaders did not heed the warnings of either the Torah, the prophet Ezekiel, or his contemporary Jeremiah. What was about to happen to them? The first thing is what we already read in the verses 4, where they would become fodder for ridicule from their neighboring kings. Deuteronomy chapter 4 tells us that God chose Israel to be a shining light to the nations. First Fruits of Zion, in their work, The Torah Club, Volume 3, the Haftarah, comments, "The other nations of the world would observe their," or Israel's, "wisdom and desire both their wisdom and their God. But Jerusalem and the rest of Israel had become the object of scorn and gossip instead." God was deeply disturbed by their behavior and lack of repentance. God's righteousness would prevail, and judgment was coming upon the great city. Ezekiel 22, 13 and 14. "Behold, therefore, I beat my fist at the dishonest prophet which you have made, and at the bloodshed which has been in your midst. Can your heart endure, or can your hands remain strong in the days when I shall deal with you? I, the Lord, have spoken and will do it." The consequences of Israel's sin, as outlined in the Torah in Deuteronomy, are progressively worse the longer Israel sins and refuses to repent. This is reflected in our Haftorah reading this week. In verse 13, God said that he would smite them with his hand. What does that mean? Several times in Israel's history, we see a smiting taking place, usually in the form of a plague or a major military defeat. Now, but they were about to face something much worse. God, the God of Israel, is a holy God, and demands holiness from his people and even more holiness from among his chosen priesthood. Something that becomes defiled or unclean must be cleansed. The princes of Israel had defiled the city. Jerusalem itself had become unclean. The remedy was clear. What had defiled the city must be removed. The inhabitants of Jerusalem faced exile and ruin, and the city would be left in flames. Ezekiel 22:15-16. I will scatter you among the nations, disperse you throughout the countries, and remove your filthiness completely from you. You shall defile yourself in the sight of the nations. Then you shall know that I am the Lord. Some scholars have proposed that in their scattering and exile, Israel is absolved of their covenant with God made at Mount Sinai. On the contrary, this exile is promised in the covenant and is part of the process of cleansing. Not only does the city need a cleansing from the filthiness which has infiltrated it, but the people as well. Verse 15 indicates that this dispersal is part of that cleansing and that they are still under the terms of the covenant. In their exile, they will be cleansed. Now, as we read on in our Haftarah, we see the process of cleansing taking place. In their exile, Israel is refined as in a furnace. Ezekiel 22:17-18. The word of the Lord came to me, saying, Son of man, the house of Israel has become dross to me. They are all bronze, tin, iron, and lead in the midst of a furnace. They have become dross from silver. Time and again, we see in Scripture where fire is used to purify and perfect the things of God. In the refiner's fire, the impurities are stripped away from the pure metals. These verses hint at the hope of Israel. Yes, the refining process is sometimes painful. Through the fire, they are refined and purified, and God is glorified. Again, from First Fruits of Zion, Torah Club, Volume 3. Israel would suffer because of their covenant unfaithfulness, yet the Israel that would emerge would be refined, seasoned, tempered, and beautiful metal. God himself would do it. Ezekiel continues with a promise of a return to the city, but first is the furnace of refinement. Ezekiel 22:19-22. Therefore, thus says the Lord God, because you have all become dross, therefore, behold, I will gather you into the midst of Jerusalem, as men gather silver, bronze, iron, lead, and tin into the midst of the furnace to blow fire on it, to melt it. So I will gather you in my anger and in my fury, and I will leave you there and melt you. Yes, I will gather you and blow on you with the fire of my wrath, and you shall be melted in the midst. As silver is melted in the midst of a furnace, so you shall be melted in its midst. Then you shall know that I, the Lord, have poured out my fury on you. Israel has faced many such trials by fire throughout their 3,500 years of history, the most recent being the Holocaust of Nazi Germany. The city of Jerusalem, like the people, needs cleansing and refining under the covenant, and God himself would do it. The prophet Zechariah speaks about this refining process. Look at Zechariah 13:8-9. And it shall come to pass in all the land, says the Lord, that 2/3 of it shall be cut off and die, but 1/3 shall be left in it. I will bring the 1/3 through the fire, will refine them as silver is refined, and test them as gold is tested. And they will call on my name, and I will answer them. I will say, this is my people. And each one will say, the Lord is my God. Now, if we have learned anything by our studies of the prophets of the Bible, it is that God is always faithful to his obligations to his covenant with Israel. They will always be his people, regardless of their iniquity and failures. They will be refined until only the Lord is their God. This process is ongoing even today. Jerusalem and Israel are still in the midst of the fire. Since their reemergence and rebirth as a nation in the aftermath of World War II, many have returned to their religious roots and many have recognized their Messiah, Yeshua. In just the last few years, for the first time in more than 2,000 years, there are more of the Jewish people living in the land of Israel than the rest of the world combined, and more are returning every day. In addition to the refining of God's land and people, we too face a personal refining. The Apostle Paul speaks of our works being tested in a refiner's fire. Look at 1 Corinthians 3:12 through 15. Now if anyone builds on this foundation with gold, silver, precious stones, wood, hay, or straw, each one's work will become clear, for the day will declare it, because it will be revealed by fire, and the fire will test each one's work of what sort it is. If anyone's work which he has built on it endures, he will receive a reward. If anyone's work is burnt, he will suffer loss. But he himself will be saved, yet so as through fire. Now God is in the midst of repairing the land and renewing the hearts and minds of His people. Those of us who have joined them in Messiah will one day also join them in the land and rejoice before the Lord on His mountain and in His holy city. I'm Dan Cathcart for Moed Ministries International. Shalom and be blessed.